Now the Bereans were noble character than the Thessalonians, for they received the message with great eagerness and examined the scriptures every day to see if what Paul said was true. Many of the Jews believed, as did also a number of prominent Greek women and many Greek men. Amen. My soul, let us become the church united in love and faithfulness. Our Father God, we thank you for granting us the grace to come before you on this holy and blessed day to worship. Please be with all our saints so we can worship you in your joyful and happiness. We pray in the name of Jesus, amen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let us pray together in repentance so that God may grant His gifts to us.
We pray
in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Holy God, our Father, thank you for giving the grace that we worship you. We did not realize your grace, and we were destined to go to hell. However, you were flogged instead of us, and you bled on the cross. So thank you, God. We cannot endure all the sufferings and the pain, so we cannot measure your pain. So, however, we thank you for your grace, and so you have set us free, and we want to live. We want to live in your will and in your hope, so that so we repent. We just live by according to our will. So we just rely on you, and we want to make a determination to live according to your will. So God, please help us. And then, so you are worthy to be praised. So you are mighty. We praise the Lord. So you do not change forever. And then you created all things, and you created all things. So we praise the Lord. And you destroyed the devil, and then you guide us into heaven. And you are with us, so I will praise the Lord. So please glorify you, be glorified by us. So as the children of God, we want to make an effort, and we want to be united according to your will. So until the church council meeting succeeded, so please be with us. So we want to restore our church. Please save our church, and all the dirty spirits will be driven away who attacks our church. So we are full of gratitude and triumph by recovering our church. So as the dark shines, the light shines the dark. We want to make a deeper fellowship with you. So we pray for our overseer who proclaims the word. So please strengthen him, and please help him with so by fulfilling your will in his ministry. So please be with by the Holy Spirit. We are thankful, and we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
So 하시나이다.
Thank you, Father God. We are grateful for the grace to come before you today and to offer our precious offerings in worship. Please remember those who have given to you dedication offering, and please bless them, and that they are remembering your dedication, so they are triumphant in lifelong dedication, and may the families who have tithed before you be blessed. So when they obey your word, they can endure the blessing that you desire to give them. And please remember and bless the families who have given monthly offerings. So in their life and in their families, with joy and the power of loving your church, and bless the families who have given thanksgiving offerings before you, granting them victory over the schemes of the enemy and giving them a testimony of thanksgiving. We pray for all the families who have given offerings today in worship, that through their offerings they may confess that all belongs to you, and that their gifts may be used beautifully for the advancement of your kingdom, your church, and the glory of Jesus' name. We thank you and pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I bless in the name of Jesus that every family and every hand that has offered the gifts in their own way before God may overflow with God's grace and blessings. Today's word of God, Ephesians chapter 4, verse 8. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 8. Let us read together. This is why it says, when he ascended on high, he took many captives and gave gifts to his people. Amen. We will listen to the sermon titled, The King Who Returns in Triumph and His Gift. So let us pray so that we can listen to the word and this, our overseer who proclaims the word. Holy God, our Father, on this holy day of the Lord, we want to receive your word. Please anoint your servant's mouth so that I proclaim your word and empower me with your wisdom and power. When I preach your word, please be with us and have faith of our saints. Pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Our God has obtained all great achievement that He fulfilled, and He is the one who uses or benefits according to His achievements for us. God's great victory prepares for the benefit for our lives. Therefore, with the benefit, God protects our lives as well. Therefore, God has not only fulfilled our salvation, but also personally guided lives after salvation. He is guiding us through those whom He grants and provided. Therefore, lives of saints and the life of the church are maintained among the grace He personally bestows. Therefore, in the church, each saint does not live their faith lives by themselves alone. God does not neglect them or spectate, but He has given such a new life that He personally guides. So in the church, there are some aspects that can be seen as same with the other worldly community, but in fact, God assists and guides their everyday lives. There is a reason why God protects everyday life and guides us. This is because He accomplished all things with such His unprecedented His power, so that we can be broken away from the enemy. Thereby, He personally guides their lives after salvation for their presence by itself. It is ongoing with such reasons. So here, while we live on earth, even though we may feel that we belong to the world in institutional position, in fact, we belong to God and we are living in God's power. The church and the saints of the Lord are living by God's power. Where does this power come from? This is a gift given by God. Therefore, it is worthy to expect that we all receive such a life and the power. It is worthy. When some saints look at other believers' splendid appearance of the faith externally, they will rather be disheartened whether they pray or do something in the church. They may think, wow, the saint is unbelievable. The saint has a spiritual power. It is amazing. Wow, how am I? I'm so normal. I envy them. Or they want to be passionate. So think, am I going well? May I be a loser? I have already failed. But do I just stay here? It is so uncertain. Now it is uncertain, then how will my future be uncertain? I just go without knowing, but am I doing well? With such unstable thoughts, they may judge their appearance of present negatively. Do I belong to God? Isn't God with me? If you do this in some perspective, it is same with covering our eyes. Rather, we may not be able to see the spiritual facts that we can see much better because we cover them by ourselves. Perhaps those who hold such an attitude misunderstand Jesus Christ, our Savior. Our Savior saved us in the past. Indeed, He saved us at the moment we believe in Him. However, since His act of redemption occurred in the past, some might think and believe that He has now withdrawn His hand. He does not act in this way. Rather, He seeks to pour out His power. Even today, through the Holy Spirit, He acts in this manner. And the reason He gave us the Holy Spirit is clearly evident here. The important thing is that He does not neglect or distance Himself
무책임하게 그냥 방치하고 멀리 두시는 것이 아니에요.
From us believers, when he treats us, instead he earnestly desires that we draw closer to him, and he is willing to bestow his power upon us without discrimination. So when we seek God, we say, wow, where is our God? My heart feels cold. This saying is partially right because it indicates a lack of faith power. They simply do not possess the power of faith. They have faith that is unable to receive power. Faith is incredibly important, as we can see from the examples of our great forefathers of faith in the Bible. In the scriptures, the term empower appears, which is so crucial. In Greek, empower is expressed as endunamu, meaning to empower, increase in strength, or strengthen. However, a proper understanding of empower emerges only when examined or the context in which this word is used. Its meaning is not immediately obvious because it is nuanced, making it challenging to grasp fully. Therefore, I present this explanation to you today. First, let's examine the word where Apostle Paul says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. What does this mean? He strengthens me. Oh, he gives me some special ability? It is a certain ability. It is not just about having the power to do any specific thing. Rather, it is the power to strengthen me. It is the word that he enables me to do something, put strength, enabling me to do the thing I thought I couldn't. In essence, he pours into me the power to accomplish things, even when I'm unaware of my own capabilities. Before he was known as Paul, Acts is recorded, Saul increased all the more in strength. Initially determined to persecute Christians, he met Jesus and fell down perfectly and stopped eating and drinking. After that, he revived and started to proclaim for Jesus and Christians. Then, what does it mean, increased all the more in strength? We may think, as things started going well for Apostle Paul, he gained more courage and vitality. However, such thought is wrong. In fact, he gained strength in reality. He acquired power. Therefore, Saul started to preach Jesus, and Jesus is Christ. Christ is Jesus, and he was filled with power. As a result, he did well more than what he had already possessed. He was made to do that. Therefore, Paul mentioned it in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 7, the Lord stood with me and strengthened me. The word strengthened has the same meaning. We are continuously looking at the same word. He strengthened me. These empowering and strengthening are synonymous. What does this mean? He strengthened me so that I could fully preach the word. I am performing far better than I could on my own. Therefore, I was delivered from the mouth of the lion despite numerous streets of death. Wherever I go, my preaching flourishes and everything is revived. Thus, I have avoided death and I am still here. Therefore, Paul continuously says, and I thank Christ Jesus and our Lord who has enabled me because he counted me faithful, putting me into this ministry. The Lord who has enabled me. This is not that I'm disciplined, but he has strengthened me. These are the same words. Be empowered, strengthened, enabled me to do. He gives power. Therefore, as he lived his own life and he was learned well in the world before believing Jesus, and he has his own knowledge, so it is not preaching without his ability, but He just fulfilled the duty entrusted by the Lord, and it was the area where he had not done. Therefore, my specialty is not this. I have something to be learned in the world, but I have another, and I have another special talent, but I should do it here. Oh, I'm so tired. There are so many enemies. I'm exhausted. After that, the Lord said, my grace is sufficient for you. And Paul realized that my strength is made perfect in weakness. It is strange. It is so strange. I wanted to boast the part I'm good at. However, when I am weak and weak and weak, I always do it there. Because the power of Christ may rest upon me. God, I want to remove this burden that bothers me. No, you should bear this burden. The Lord does not resolve this problem. He does not answer this prayer. He leaves me in my weakness. As I'm weak and unstable, he just lets me be. Therefore, in my weakness, the Lord is carrying out his work. Thus, it is not the Apostle Paul who is doing well, but the Lord working through him. That is the principle. What matters to us is faith. What can be considered the greatest of all is faith. And without faith, no problem can be perfectly resolved. Everything will be burdened. So our faith should be firmly established. When we look at the praise, without faith, pleasing God remains elusive, or our labors without belief in vain. In every place where life has crumbled down, wait for you, Lord. Wait to be restored. This is the praise song. When we hear this song, it is easy to think that if we are without faith, those who are without faith will be scolded by God. However, it is wrong. When we look at it now, God is willing to grant faith. He strengthens my faith. If we are strengthened, we should have faith, and our faith life is doing well. Then please give me the faith. I cannot. How do I give you as you neglect your inner man? The inner man should be strengthened. We should awake the inner man and make it strong. You should be strong in the power of his might so you can defeat the enemy. What is the problem of believers? The problem that believers must be fearful. This is they are tempted and deceived by the enemies. Even they are working for Satan. It is because their faith has no power. They do not have any centeredness. They should look at God directly, but they cannot, so they are tempted. Therefore, when the Apostle Paul taught his disciple, he said, you should be strong in the grace. What does it mean? Be strong in the grace. Your everyday life is living by power he is helping with. And this is called grace. Your life of today dwells in the grace. You are under the God's warm protection. That is grace. You are under his encouragement within it. You should be strengthened. You should receive what he gives to you. Of course, as I say to you, that the Apostle Paul is so exemplary and special, that there is no rule that we should be same with him. However, the principle isn't going in this way. Even if the range is small and we are weak, similarly, by that principle, we are leading our faith lives. In this discussion, as we share these words together, there's an important truth. Why would the Lord, after already providing salvation through Jesus, continue to want to give us more? It's because it's crucial for the Lord to give strength and empowerment. Why is this important? It's significant because it holds a great meaning to Him. Giving these gifts isn't random without any background. Christ is given, aren't given without thought, as if saying, here, take this, I have too much. Also, there is not a generous intent to share, not merely out of abundance, but driven by a genuine desire to give. There's a reason behind it. Not given without meaning or background, but with a compelling desire to give. The reason is that whatever is name or firm, what is given to us is the souvenir of His glory. It's like a miniature trophy of the Lord's own trophies. What is this? It is a souvenir of the victories He has achieved. This is given as a pledge of His honor with His own name, in the name of Jesus. What does it mean to give in the name of Jesus? It means that what I give to you, I give so that you may remember me, thank, and rely on me with my personality and honor. When we receive this gift, it prompts us to remember Him. Thank you, my Lord of victory. I will commemorate you, Lord Jesus, Jesus Christ, Jesus Christ, proudly. We will boast. Oh God, Lord, thank you. Thank you, Lord. Truly, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. He is my Lord. He is my Lord of power. When I think of the Lord, He is not a figure of weakness or frailty, but a Lord of power. Thank you, Lord, the Lord. You are the Lord of power. And you are the sovereign of the greatest victory, sufficient for me to rely on you. That is what I believe. That is why He gives. When He gives a souvenir or a gift, it's not just a simple, oh, thank you for the gift. Rather, it represents His best victories. The momentum. Of His triumphs and His name, which is the greatest and meant to be proclaimed to all nations. So, do not merely view what our Lord has given as a mark of generosity. Remember it as a meaningful gift, a proud offering from our Lord who protects us. I bless in the name of Jesus that you will remember this. Hallelujah. I earnestly hope that God, who wishes to share generously with you all, will not be limited. Today, let's examine the scripture. Today's passage is about a king, a victorious general, returning from conquest, our king. Last week, we are told each one of us' grace was given according to the measure of Christ's gift. It is saying how He intends to distribute these gifts evenly. Thus, the word speaks of the principle of grace that God bestows, its fundamental, basic principle. And today, We look into the question, but what is the background of this gift? What circumstances led to their giving? We are looking to understand where the authority to give this gift comes from. Why does the Lord give in this way? What kind of person is he? And what special qualifications does he have bestowed this gift? What's the background to this? This is what the scripture addresses today. The basis for giving gifts is the focus of the today's scripture. So let us read together. Therefore it says, when he ascended on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts to man. The content of today's scripture seems to be ascending initially, followed by somewhat mysterious phrase. He led captivity captive, and then mentions he gave gift. These three elements are introduced with, therefore it says, which indicates that this passage is borrowed from the Old Testament. Specifically, it is taken from Psalm chapter 68, particularly verse 18. In fact, the reference to Psalm chapter 68 as a whole aligns with this verse, and it's verse 18 that is specifically quoted to match the context of the discussion. Of course, there is a notable difference in the text. Today's scripture says he gave, whereas the original text from which it is derived actually says he received. This difference has led to a theological debate. It is clear that during the translation process into Greek, the text of the Old Testament was changed. This modification by the Jews claiming this is correct and the original was wrong is exactly what Apostle Paul uses in his writings. Therefore, there is no need for you to be troubled by the issue. I have grappled with it on your behalf. You can simply listen comfortably and move on. What we are discussing here involves going to war, fighting battles, and returning with spoils of war. Have any of you ever been to war? Have you ever engaged in life or death battle? Probably not, as it's been a while since such times. This concept might seem unsigned to us. Our understanding comes from stories over 200 years old, but for much of human history, spanning tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of years, this was a common. Today, however, we live in a completely different world, one that is drastically removed from those times of constant warfare. Originally, different communities and societies would fight each other. This struggle has always been a part of human history. Although today we don't typically engage in combat with swords, in the past, the tribes would attack other tribes. What would happen if they won? It wasn't as if they defeated would simply say, we surrender, oh, we've lost, and the victors would respond, all right, don't mess with us again, and leave it at that. Instead, the victors didn't just make them swear not to rebel again. There was often wiping out the defeated group entirely. This ruthless approach was a common practice in ancient times. This behavior of plunder in historical context was not considered inherently bad. It was a natural human behavior, the act of defeating an opponent and taking everything of value for money to useful items, even clothing, was commonplace. In times when resources were scarce, not as abundant as today, even a single piece of clothing was worth taking. They kill everything that should be killed, and they kill any potential for future troubles. Only some are taken as slaves, and they seize all goods. So, when war occurs, the defeated side isn't just sad because we lost. There is no one left to be sad. Everything is destroyed. So David did the same. It wasn't a question of why did David do it, but rather it was the way human society functioned at the time. David, following God's command, acted according to the innate tendencies of human life at the time. He took the spoils of war and distributed them. He shared with those who had been loyal to him, his people, and everyone else. He declared, "Here is a present for you from the spoil of the enemies of the Lord." He gave to this person here, to that person there, to everyone. He engaged in many wars and battles. So naturally, there were many spoils. This is what happens in war. Battle yields spoils. This aspect also appears in the book of Isaiah, where Christ is depicted as a suffering servant. It states, "Therefore I will divide him in a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong." This refers to the soldiers who flogged Christ and took his belongings, including his clothes. Jesus, as the suffering servant and the defeated one, had everything taken from him, down to his undergarments and even the cloth on his head. He was stripped of all his possessions. The crucial element here is the spoils of war. The victor takes all. So when a king goes to war or participates in a specific battle, he overcomes the enemies who have been threatening his citizens, the people of the city or nation. Upon returning victorious, he partakes in a triumph parade. He might ride on a chariot or on a horseback. This scene is vividly presented to us. When the king, serving as the general, leads his people into battle and emerges victorious, returning with a parade, imagine the reaction of the citizens. They are overwhelmingly joyous. This isn't just about pride or celebration, it's a matter of survival. Without the king's victory, they would live in constant fear and insecurity, their lives perpetually on the edge. But having triumphed so competently, how much applause would he receive? They would be thankful, relieved that amidst their tough lives, hope has restored with the return of a steadfast king. During the parade, the king would bring back spoils of war, accompanied by his soldiers who fought alongside him. He would also bring back captives, including those of his own people who had been captured and were not rescued. Imagine this procession ascending to Jerusalem. A spectacle filled with significance. Recall how people are welcomed and they celebrate Jesus with applause, singing and dancing when he entered the temple during Passover. The scene was a triumphant entry, a celebration of victory. So at the parade, as the king enters, he is warmly welcomed by the people, but he also puts on a display, "Look, see my officers." my spoils, my loot. Imagine how delightful the sight of a dead disposal would be before the citizens. They would shout, "Share it, share it!" And he would generously distribute the spoils, parts of clothing, and more, while the display serves as a spectacle. It also boosts the moral of his people. It's the way of saying, "You're a king, your general is here." This lifts the spirits of the people immensely. And what's the crucial during this procession? You see people some bandaged like a parade, with an eye patch, others with a broken arm in a sling, and still others leaning on canes. Some are riding carts, wrapped tightly bandages, barely able to lift their faces, weakly waving their hands. Who are they? These are the captives who have been rescued. They have been brought back. Among them, there's the son whom everyone thought was dead. For all this time, there was no news of him, captured by the enemy, his fate unknown, his body never found. The husband of someone believed that also returned. Their general has saved them. They wave their hands in weak but grateful gestures as they pass by a cheering crowd. When the citizens see this, they are overjoyed. The display is not just about showing off his achievement, it's a message of encouragement to the people. Do not be afraid. Do not fear. Be courageous. I will protect you. The logic here is that by recapturing those who were once taken captive, I bring the captives back within my realm. I set them free. It's my duty under my name to grant them liberation. This is the principle. So, this message depicts Christ's triumphant entry into heaven after his victory. The phrase, "therefore," he says, is attached in the scripture to convey this, appearing in context that carry an immense weight, almost like a divine command. This isn't just the casual commentary. It's a proclamation used only in moments of a profound divine expression. I mentioned that this passage is from Psalm chapter 68. David achieved victory and joyously returned to Zion, bringing the Ark of the Covenant with him. He wrote a psalm about his triumph and taking spoils. But it is expressed in the Bible as a victory accomplished by God. He defeated the Jebusites and captured the city of David. Then, as described in 2 Samuel chapters 5 and 6, he continued to fight the Philistines and reclaimed the Ark of the Covenant. There are many stories associated with his journey to bring the Ark up to Jerusalem. Upon his victorious return, David danced with such joy that he even embarrassed. So, he even embarrassed his wife while the people played the tambourine, sang, and made a great commotion. He was ecstatic with happiness, returning home without a careful appearances, celebrating and giving thanks to his God. This content is found in the Psalms chapter 68, but since we cannot read it or hear, I will select and explain just a few verses for you. Let God arise, let his enemies be scattered. Let those who also who hate him flee before him. As smoke is driven away, so drive them away. As wax melts before the fire, so let the wicked perish at the presence of God. Kings of armies flee, they flee, and she who remains at home divides the spoil. Even the women who work in the household go out and take spoils, because the king's might in battle is so strong that the spoils overflow, allowing even the women to collect them abundantly. When the Almighty scattered the kings in it, therefore, when the Almighty scattered kings in it, it was white as snow in Salmon. When the king appears, it's as if the snow swirling around Mount Zermon. While the exact meaning might be unclear, it visually suggests that just as snow flurries scatter in the wind, so too the earth flee when the king makes his entrance as he brandishes with sword enemy scatter. Why do you fume with envy, your mountains of many peaks? This is the mountain which God desires to dwell in. Yes, the Lord will dwell in it forever. The chariots of God are 20,000, even thousands of thousands. The army of the Lord is strong and numerous. The Lord is among them as in Sinai, in the holy place. You have ascended on high. He ascends to the high places. In the past, this was seen as Mount Sinai. But now it refers to ascending to Mount Zion. In truth, it means the ascension of Jesus Christ into heaven. You have led captivity captive. You have received gifts among men. As mentioned earlier, in reality, it is given to humanity that the Lord God might dwell there. Blessed be the Lord who daily loads with the benefits the God of our salvation, Selah. Every day he bestows his blessings. Our God is the God of salvation. He is our Lord of salvation. And to God the Lord belong escapes from death. He who gives me life and triumphs over death is God. But God will wound the head of his enemies, the heavenly scarf of the one who still goes on in his trespasses. This vividly described passage depicts God striking down the wicked and crushing their heads. The Lord said, I will bring back from Bashan, I will bring them back from the depths of the sea. Those who were taken captive, scattered, or whose fates were unknown, or are gathered and brought back. That your foot may crush them in blood. It is a scene where, empowered by your general, your gathered strength and your food may cross in blood and the tongues of your dogs. Dogs running forward snatch their food from the enemy, reclaiming what they needed to survive. They have seen your procession, O God. They are looking at parades, the procession of my God, my King, into the sanctuary. Among them were women who beat the tambourines, women bearing tambourines, making noise with them. The singers went before, the players on instruments followed after, dancing, singing, and making a fuss. Your God has commanded you strength. Strengthen, O God, what you have done for us. Ascribe strength to God. His excellence is over Israel. And his strength is in the clouds. O God, you are more awesome than your holy places. The God of Israel is he who gives strength and power to his people. Blessed be God. Amen. It is victorious Christ who engages in battle on this earth, achieving great triumphs. He doesn't just decide, let's do it this way and that way. There's a cause he bears. He puts his life on the line, wins the great victory, and then shares the spoils with the people. He rescues captives, those who were taken captive, bringing them back. This fact is already expressed in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 20, and following in a more moderate language. Two important points to mention are, firstly, that he retrieves those who are taken captive, and secondly, that he rescues and redeems them. He died on the cross. The significance of his battle leading to this was quite remarkable. He died, but death could not hurt him. He broke through death, rose again, conquered sin, conquered Satan, and resurrected. Through his resurrection, he stripped off all authority and power, disarming the enemy completely. What is authority and power? It's defeating all supernatural beings or celestial powers, or rebellious beings in heaven and on earth, defeating the devil and those who follow them. He does this openly for all to see, and he did a parade. He triumphed on the cross. The eyes of this world do not see this fact. They do not even try to hear it. Yet, here is the clear revelation of Christ giving, the victory he achieved, which allows us to see the gift he has given us. Once prisoners of the enemy, they are now in the hands of God. They return to their land, to their people, to their city, to their home with these uncomfortable bodies. When he ascended on high, he led captivity captive. We can now assume that there are still those who belong to him but have not yet been redeemed. Took the captives captive. Not everyone has been brought back yet, right? There may still be others in different regions who are captured, still in the grave of Satan. And they are still in the darkness as well. They remain in the clutches of Satan. If the Lord had not fought and achieved the victory for them, if he had not thrown himself into death, fought against the attacks of death and sin, and risen again, they would have remained there, but he rescued and saved them. There will continue to be others to rescue in the future. When we see these words in the Bible, it seems that there are still more people to be saved. The Apostle Paul is now planning to leave Corinth. There's been so much persecution there. However, the Lord said, "Don't go." Oh Lord, I want to go. I want to leave. I don't like it here. I have many people in this city. Don't leave. Go and save them. So he couldn't leave. He worked there for another year and a half. In other parts of the Bible, it also mentions there are still souls I needed to save, souls I must bring to salvation. There are sheep, you know, in our flock, and other sheep I have which are not of this world, them I must bring. Also, in other parts of the Bible, it mentions how God continues to gather his scattered children to become one. Furthermore, in other parts of the Bible, after this, I will return and will rebuild the tabernacle of David, which has fallen down. In these passages, the ongoing plan to seek the Lord by those who are not yet saved and all the Gentiles who are called by my name is mentioned. So those who have been saved, they are the ones who were once captured, just like our beloved ones, and they were captured and brought to the Lord. However, there are still more people to be rescued. Furthermore, the second most important thing is that when he ascended on high, he gave gifts to his people. Here, a different Greek word is used. So, There's no need for confusion with the previous statements. The word used here gives a clear sense of broader, more comprehensive gift, implying a wider range gifts, a completely different word, the gifts given by the conqueror. He gave spoils to his people when he ascended on high and led captives in his train and gave gifts to man. What we shouldn't confuse here is that it's not about receiving what he took away as gift, but rather it's about the gifts that his victory brings, akin to the spoils of war on the battlefield. It means the gifts that he himself generates through his victory. Because of his triumph, he gives us things that are now a joy to us, a commemoration of the glory resulting from his victory, gifts that fully reveal his triumph to us. He is our Savior, since the Holy Spirit after his ascension. Upon being glorified, when the Holy Spirit comes, He is also a gift. He Himself, the Holy Spirit, is the gift sent by Christ, and through the coming of the Holy Spirit, gifts will continue to come in the future. Now the Holy Spirit becomes the mediator entirely, bringing gifts continually. What is the content of this gift? It's the gift of empowerment. So, even speaking in tongues, do you know where these gifts come from? It is said in the Acts of the Apostles. The Psalm chapter 68 was once thought to be about Moses by the Jews. It was thought to be about Moses going on Mount Sinai, receiving the law, and coming down to deliver it and so on. Now it turns out it was about the Savior, the Redeemer Jesus Christ, who would come in the future to save the whole world. In the past, it was thought to be about Moses. And also the Feast of First Fruits, the Thanksgiving for the harvest. When they entered the land of Canaan and planted their first crop, saying, "We offer to God what is new and the first in the land that God has promised." It's not just about taking the first fruits when harvesting, but actually going there, planting new crops, and offering the first fruits entirely to God. That's what the Feast of First Fruits is about. This scene, this passage, Psalm chapter 68, verse 18, commemorates the meaning of this feast of first fruits and the glory given to the Lord. Exactly, it seems to align perfectly with our current time. If we consider the recent worship for the Resurrection Day we shared a few days ago, it's been about 30 days since the resurrection, today being the 29th day. Jesus ascended after 40 days on this earth following his resurrection, and then 10 days later, the Holy Spirit descended. So after his ascension, he received glory, and along with the glory came the gift of the Holy Spirit. Likewise, after ascending to heaven and receiving glory, Jesus began to give gifts, not only the Holy Spirit, but continuous support as well. This support refers to Jesus' exaltation, meaning his victory being acknowledged throughout heaven. Then, the Lord doesn't just leave us. He not only legally redeems us, but also showers us with grace and give to careful and nurture us. Among all the gifts He intends to give us, what we should prioritize is His strengthening us and making us strong, especially in faith. Otherwise, those without faith may end up being exploited by the enemy. Strengthening our faith should be the foremost priority, and we need to seek in order to be strengthened. Also, we should live each day relying on the grace for strength. In the next session, it seems important to examine the significant fact of what rights He gives us through His grace. What battles did He fight? What is the meaning of these gifts He gives us? Beloved, it's not a matter of take it or leave it when He gives us His grace. We shouldn't think of it that way. He doesn't give it casually or without significance. He gives it with great enthusiasm, saying, "This is the work of my victory." He shares His triumph with you in a glorious way, saying, "This is my souvenir. This is the gift of my victory." In the name of Jesus, He says, "When you receive my gift, my honors is in this gift. Remember me. Recognize me. Remember that I am your Lord. I am the God of power. I am the God of power. I am the ultimate victor. I am the Savior you can rely on." Hallelujah. I bless that you receive what the Lord gives with gratitude, cherishing it as a precious gift in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Let us pray. Our God, we thank you for saving us and leading us through today's life, and for the gifts you bestow upon us. We desire to receive all that you will give. We ask for the grace of our Lord to make us strong and firm in faith every day, especially to start everything perfectly. By strengthening our faith, we want to receive your gifts. Please give me many gifts. Let us pray together with earnest hearts. Holy God, our Father, we pray for all those souls who have heard your word today. Help them, touch them, and reveal your glory within them so that they may all have the courage to rise anew. Let no one take for granted what you give, and may everyone receive your daily empowerment so they welcome you, enable them to embrace you, receive strength, and above all, strengthen their faith. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. So let us all stand together. So with God's victory And so let us reflect all the gifts through His triumph. So please strengthen our faith. Let us give a big applause toward our God.
Hallelujah!
Hallelujah! May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the sincere love of our God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with all of us who have a service together in our souls and in our lives from now and forever. Amen.
우리를 받으신 하나님 앞에 감사의 뜨거운 박수를 올립시다.
Let us glorify our God Father who has accepted us today.
우리 교회가 분열 사태로 인해서
So through the division state Our church has suffered for a long time, so we should solve this problem, and so we should be united and at peace, and so all the spiritual enemies will be driven away, and I hope to live a happy faith life in happiness. So without our efforts, we cannot do anything. So Our Lord is our Master, and we should gather our hearts, and we should fight against the devil and enemy. So some leave our church because it is too burdened. However, it is our burden that our Lord has entrusted to us. So please make your effort to restore our church. So please do not be deceived by the enemy. And so the Lord who belongs to heaven planted hope in our hearts. So let us not doubt and move forward to our Lord firmly. So let us earnestly hope that God helps us. And let us hope that God has bestowed His gifts to us. Hallelujah. Dear beloved, thank you so much.